Hello, hello, hello. How are you guys doing tonight? Should we start the vlog off with Peter crying? I was like just bawling my eyes out listening to some country music. Do you ever like just cry because you're like so like, I know this is gonna sound crazy, but you cry just because like you're so happy, like in a weird way, like you just feel so in touch with like the world and you feel so blessed for your life. Like, I was just listening to that song People Is Crazy by Billy Currington. I love Billy Currington. And I was just like sitting there, and if you don't know the song, it's about, he's in a bar and he meets this guy and they're sitting there talking, and like they have a beer and they're talking about like, you know, the women they married and being in the war and stuff like that. And then the guy dies and he's like a millionaire and he leaves all of his money to this guy. I don't know why it makes me cry, but anyway, and he says in there, I love, the line is, he says, his kids were mad as hell, but me, I'm doing well. And then he's like, I drove by his grave today and left a 6-pack right there on his grave. And, I don't know, I was just like thinking about all the people in my life, you know, that like I've met through the years. And, I like stuff. I do. I mean, I am not even going to BS about it. I like stuff, but it just isn't important, you know? And I like traveling, and I like nice hotel rooms. Nice hotel rooms are some of my favorite things in the entire world. There's nothing like opening that door in a new hotel room that you've never stayed in before, you know? I love that. And I love going on trips with my husband. And but like all of it is really rather priceless, you know, or all of that is worthless in comparison to the pricelessness of an exchange with another human being, or, you know, memories that you have or times that you spent with them. And my friend that moved back here, he and I have been like texting all day today, and I didn't really realize how much I missed him, you know, until we're like texting and trying to figure out like when to hang out. And he has total free time, and so I was like, yeah, I have a lot of free time too, so let's get together. And he was like a really good friend of mine, and like Alex loves him too, and but like he's a sober friend of mine, and we used to like just sit on his patio and talk, and we go to Waffle House like 3 nights a week, and we drive around and listen to music. We loved a lot of the same kind of music. He like introduced me to so much great music, like The National and some other bands, and just really great music. And we would just talk, and I remember one night he got like a group of people to go see shooting stars out in the middle of nowhere, like in this cornfield. And he was like, we got to bring blankets and stuff. And I was like, I don't know how I feel about this. It's kind of scary. And I remember telling Alex, and Alex was like, Alex had something else he was doing that night. And he was like, that is so hilarious. You got, we were going to, like, we used to go to this candlelight meeting. This was before I was going to a lot of candlelight meetings. This was a candlelight meeting I used to go. It doesn't even exist anymore on the north side. And we all kind of like started the meeting. And so we would go to like this candlelight meeting, and then we would go to, go back. When I came back into going to meetings, I hadn't gone to meetings in 4 years. So if you don't know my story, I've been sober for 24 and a half years. And, but I stopped going to meetings about, 6 months after Alex and I started dating. And I had some issues with God. I was kind of angry. I think it was a lot of my grieving that I didn't really, really understand. You know, my, like, God taking my mom from me. I'd had a disagreement with somebody in recovery, and which is so stupid because he's like one of my best friends today. I've told that story on here about Walt. I can tell it again, and if you don't know it, about the amends that happened between he and I, because that's like a really neat thing. I actually just sat and talked to him last night. So anyway, when I came back in, so what had happened was I had no emotional sobriety. And what that means is emotional sobriety is that you take the drugs away, you take the drink away, the alcohol, but like there's still so much to fix within somebody, right? Which is why people recommend 12-step programs or counseling or church or, you know, some spiritual outlet or something like that, right? To deal with all of that stuff that's inside that made you to some degree. I mean, I believe in having a genetic predisposition for some people. I definitely have it. But I also believe that, you know, we drink and drug because we have a lot of issues. And like over the years, we complicate that because we drink on top of those issues or drug on top of those issues. And then we complicate those issues. And so we never really heal them. We just kind of band-aid them with the using. Well, I think most people know that doesn't take the stuff away. It doesn't take the pain away. And you have all this pain inside. And then you take the drink and the drug away. And if you don't replace that with something positive, something spiritual in your life, you know, something healing in your life, then you're just empty. Well, I was empty at that point in my life. And I wasn't happy, but I could put on a real good mask. And there was about, I mean, I wouldn't say the whole time that I was out, not going to meetings, I wasn't happy. I mean, I was happy, but like for like 2 years, a year and a half, 2 years of my life, like of that period, like our relationship was not great. It had a lot to do with my emotional sobriety. It had to do with that Alex and I were just completely on two different pages. And I just was miserable. I had no spiritual foundation in my life, which for me, and I'm only speaking from my experience, is important to me to have some kind of spiritual connection with my higher power. And I had no spiritual connection in my life. I think it was the first time since I've gotten sober that, okay, first of all, I just have to tell you on a side note that I like took these candle waxes out tonight, and like I took them out to put new ones in, and they must have been like some kind of fall or apple scent that I had in there last, because all I can smell now, it just smells like apple. It smells like kitchen. But you know, I think for the first time since I had gotten sober, I mean, I didn't get sober and like immediately like have this strong faith in a higher power. Like that took a little while. But when I did, from that point going on, like, and I consider myself a spiritual person, not a religious person. Not that I think it matters. I think if you're religious and that works for you, I think that's great. You know, my mom was a pretty religious person. She went to church every Sunday. She was very involved in her church and things like that. And I know other people that are like that. But for me, it's not where I get it. And that's one of the things I love about 12-step programs is they don't force that on you. It's up to you. Like, people all the time say to me, like, can atheists and agnostics get sober? Absolutely. Absolutely. I have lots of friends of mine that are atheists and agnostic and are sober. And they just work the program of recovery in 12 steps in that way. And it's even addressed in the basic text of several programs. It's addressed. It's addressed, I know, in the basic text of most 12-step programs. Is it encouraged to find a spiritual experience? Yes, it is. But I think a definition of a spiritual experience is different to everybody. I did my hair earlier. It's so long. I'm getting my hair cut tomorrow. Because I went out to dinner with Alex and my cousin Caroline and her son came. So it was real fun. And then I ran into some old friends of mine, sober friend of mine and his mom. It was so random. And so they came over and talked to us. And I remember him like the day he got sober. And he was like, I just had 10 years. I was like, are you kidding me? Anyway, it was just really cool to see him and his family. So anyway, and I wonder how old he is now. He's probably 40. I remember when he came in. But anyway, it was good to see him. And so anyway, I like did my hair and I had like this plaid shirt that I showed in my haul. Did I show it in my haul video? I think I did. I wore that tonight because Alex likes that shirt, or he liked that shirt when I showed it to him, so I wore it. But anyway, you know, I think like since the time that I got sober, like I had never questioned my faith in my higher power. And then my mom died, and I think I had a real childish attitude towards God, and I was like, okay, so God took the one person that was important to me. I mean, Alex was important to me, my friends were important, Tanya's important, my dad, my stepmom were important to me, but my mom and I were extremely close, you know? And I'm like, and we shared recovery, and I'm like, you know, which today, I know that the world doesn't work that way. I know that my higher power doesn't work that way, you know? It's not like that. It's not like, but I have this kind of like, it's not fair kind of attitude, you know? And then I became kind of angry. And I think I just used that as an excuse to distance myself. And I just was angry inside and I wasn't happy. And I wasn't, you know, working on stuff. And I just was, you know, I just wasn't happy. So it was bad. It was like every day. I would sit on the front porch and I would just like smoke cigarettes and play solitaire on my phone. Like when I came home. And I remember Alex was like standing outside the door one night and he just kind of looked at me and he was like, you know, and in our marriage, like at that point was rough, and it wasn't me and it wasn't him. It was both of us. Both of us contributed to it, you know? And he looked at me and he said, I don't know what you need from me and I don't know what we need to do, but I cannot just continue to sit here and watch you like every day. Like this is just, I don't know how to help you, you know? And I just was like, I mean, anytime anybody would say anything to me, Tanya called me like, I mean, I saw Tanya just as much then as I do now. But she, you know, she continued to go to meetings and work with her sponsor and stuff. And she would ask me every week, do you want to go to the meeting? And I would be like, nope, I'm good. And I think the one thing that saved my ass was that, like, I think the huge thing that saved my ass was that I didn't pick up. I don't know how. You know, Tanya would say to me back then, I don't know how you're not going to meetings and you're not working a program and you're not staying sober. Because she knew I was miserable, right? But, like, I'd be like, I don't, like, we would go out to bars, like, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, you know? And, like, we would have VIP sections and bottle service, and people would bring me, like, 5 Red Bulls because they just knew I was sober. I think me being honest about my sobriety and just always saying that I was sober was one thing that saved my ass. And I think the other thing was, well, and so I didn't pick up, you know? I think the other thing was, I never said I didn't need it. I never said, like, I don't need it anymore. Or, yeah, I did that for a while and I don't need it. Like, I had been sober enough, and I mean, like, worked a program enough that I knew. Like, I mean, it had been, like, 14 years. I knew I needed it, right? So, I never said, I don't need this. Like, I start talking about my friend, and now I've gone off on a completely different tangent. But I never said, like, I don't need this. I don't need to go anymore. I don't need this. Like, I never said that, right? So I kind of kept one foot in. My sponsor would call me from time to time. But that was really it. Like, I mean, for 4 years, that was really all the connection that I had was Tanya and my sponsor from, you know, I'd see Tanya 3 times a week, 4 times a week. And then my sponsor would call me probably, I don't know, every 2 weeks or something like that. And be like, just checking in, how you doing? And so I don't know what happened. I honestly don't. I mean, I like in recovery, we call these things God moments sometimes. And it must have been a God moment for me. I still haven't finished my coffee from today. But and this is what I'm talking about. Like, things are nice, travel is nice, all this kind of stuff. But, like, the people that I have had in my life have just really, I just really saved my ass, you know, and just really given me moments that have made my life just this amazing journey that it is. So, I don't know what happened. I got up one day, it was in January, we were having a bad snowstorm. And I had, like, a bunch of stuff to do that day. I had, like, just BS stuff, like laundry. I mean, I was still functioning, you know? But I had, like, laundry to... I was standing in the kitchen at my counter where I vlog in my kitchen. I was standing right there. And I had a list, and I was making... Because, you know, I always keep lists. And I was, like, do laundry, fold laundry, put away towels, vacuum. And I got to, like, vacuum or something. I don't know. And I just... lost it. Like, I absolutely lost it. I was bawling my eyes out. I just felt like I can't go on. Like, I don't know what else to do. And I don't know what it was. I honest to God have no idea what it was that, like, in my head put this thought, but I was like, you need to get to a meeting. And you need to get Tanya to take you to a meeting. Like, if I wasn't going to... I was too afraid to walk back in by myself. Because I was like, all these people are going to be talking about me. I haven't seen them in 4 years. I don't know any of these people anymore. Blah, 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 whatever. And I had left and kind of been like, F you to a lot of these people. Because I was not in a great space, right? And so I was afraid to walk back in. I was afraid that these people wouldn't like me anymore. They wouldn't love me anymore, you know? And so I called Tanya on the phone and I said, I just was crying. And she said, what's wrong, babe? And I said, would you please take me to a meeting? It was a Tuesday night. And I said, would you please take me to a meeting tonight? And she said, I've been praying for 4 years for you to ask me that. This is why, like, this is the shit that, like, people don't get that are outside of it. Like, this is why sobriety and addiction is so serious to me. I mean, it is consuming of people's lives. Okay, this was me, at this point, 17, 18 years sober. I was ready to die more than I was the day that I came in sober. I mean, let me just tell you, okay? So... I don't take this stuff lightly. This week alone, I've heard of 2 overdoses, okay? Addiction and recovery is so serious to me. I'm not even engaging in conversations with people that want to make jokes about it. I won't even have that fun. I won't even engage in that conversation with them if they think it's funny. If they think anything about it is funny or whatever, I don't even engage in the conversation. I just, it's pure ignorance to me. Because if that's where I was, with no emotional sobriety, no spiritual foundation, at 4 years, almost 4 years of not going to a meeting, you know, imagine people out there that are struggling for their life on a daily basis using. So anyway, she took me to a meeting that night, and... she was like, oh, do you want to go to our home group? And because it's on Tuesday nights, like, you guys probably know that by now. And I was like, anywhere but there. I mean, I was like, I'm not walking back in there, right? Like, no, 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 no. And she was like, okay, where do you want to go? And so we went to this clubhouse. And there were like 4 or 6 people there. It was real small because it was like this horrible winter weather outside. It was like a lot of snow and stuff. And so we go in and there was this other woman there that I had known previously. Well, she had been like out, like, and not going to meetings too. And so our story, it was just such a God moment. It was so weird. Like, she sat there and talked and it was my story. And she was like, I was angry at the recovery. I was angry at the program. I was angry at God. I was just sitting there and I was like, this is me, you know? And I don't even know, like, have you ever just like, it just like all comes off you and you shake it and it's just like this huge weight off your shoulders. Like, that's how I felt. I literally left that meeting that night like how people explain, like when they're like baptized in church. Like that's how I felt. Like I felt cleansed. I felt free. I felt like, okay, I'm back. Like I felt good again, right? And so then on the way home, like Tanya and I are talking, and then we went to her house and I saw her husband Eric, and this is the funniest part of the story, but I said to her, hey, do you want to go to like a noon meeting tomorrow? And she said, babe, I've been going to meetings the entire time that you've been out. Like, it'd be good for you to go, but I don't need to go tomorrow. Like, I'm good for a couple days, right? And I didn't want to go to the meeting by myself the next day alone either, but she was like, it'll be really good for you to go alone. And that night, it was like, I think it was that night, I listened to this lead. There's like this app. Well, you can listen to leads on YouTube. They have like all of these fantastic leads. If you put in like women recovery speakers or sober speakers, it'll pull up all these. I mean, the women ones are the greatest. I love them. There's some fantastic ones on there. If you want specific names of ones that I would suggest, contact me and I'll let you know. But anyway, I listened to this woman, and she had gotten sober when she was like really young, like 14 or 15, and she was like 40 35 40, and I was listening to her lead. I think it was that night, and she said, if it wasn't that night, it was right around there, and she said, it's hard to fall off the wagon when you're sitting in the middle of it. And I heard that, and it hit me like a ton of bricks, because I was like, that was the one thing I never did before. Like, I never got real involved, you know? And so I was like, if I'm going to come back and do this deal, I'm going to do the deal. And I'm going to put my hand out and shake people's hands and introduce myself, even when it's uncomfortable and awkward. And I'm going to get to know people. And, you know, that's what I'm going to do. Like, I'm going to do this thing, and I'm going to share openly about what's going on with me in meetings. I'm not going to come anymore and just be like, everything's okay. Like, if everything's not okay, I'm going to say everything's not okay. And if something's going on with me, I'm going to share my truth, and I'm going to get healthy, and I'm going to get well, and this is what's going to happen. And I'm not going out all the time anymore, and all this kind of stuff. So I came home that night, and Alex and I sat down, and we had a real serious conversation. And there's this lead that I like. It's such a fantastic lead, and it's by this woman that got sober. She's been sober like, I don't know, 25. She's probably been sober about the same amount of time as me, maybe. I don't know, maybe longer. And I've never met her, but I would love to meet her. I've heard her lead so many times from different conventions. She's a circuit speaker. She goes around and speaks at different conventions. She and her husband and her daughter, they all go speak. And she talked about how she got sober, and I heard her lead like literally within the first couple days, because I related to it so much. It's so hot in this car. I don't know why I'm telling the story. I'm getting so emotional tonight. I don't know. Maybe I needed to retell it tonight or something. But she talked about how, like, her husband was, like, she was drinking and drinking and drinking. And she actually started drinking later in life. She had never drank, like, when she was younger. Her, like, her kids were, like, at that time, like, 14 and 12 or something. And she hadn't drank until they were like in school. And then she started going to these women's things. And it's a fun. This story is actually on YouTube. If you want to hear it, let me know and I'll tell you who it is. And you can look it up. Her lead is on YouTube. And she said, so she started going to these like women's afternoon like teas. Well, they would drink at the tea. And so like she went, and it's like these funny drinks. I can't remember what it was that she would drink. But she started realizing that she could like have a couple drinks before she went. It sounds fun. I mean, we laugh in recovery about these things now when we look back on the foolishness of our stories. But because we all like have thought the same things, right? And so she thought, like, well, if I'm going to go there, I'm going to have a couple drinks anyway. I could probably have a couple drinks before I go. Well, before she knew it, she was drinking in the middle of the day and not even, like, before her kids got home from school. And she wasn't even going to these women's things anymore, you know, these luncheons and teas or whatever they were. And she just developed, like, this really, and she had a predisposition for addiction in her family anyway. And she didn't know about, talks about that later. She found out later, but, like, it was like a grandparent or something, I think. And so she goes to treatment. And, like, the day that she gets out of treatment, her husband picks her up, and the counselor, like, sits down with them and is like, okay, now she needs to go to, you know, meetings, and she looked at the counselor looked at the husband and was like, and I really recommend that you go to Al-Anon, which is the sister program to Alcoholics Anonymous. It's a 12-step program for friends and family members of alcoholics and addicts. And she said, and you know, Al-Anon also has Alateen for your kids to go. And so, and the counselor was like, oh, and by the way, this weekend, there is this weekend retreat for families, and you guys should all go. And so they go home. They go on the, so they don't even leave, like, to go home. They go straight to this retreat, okay? If you want to talk about a family that's in it to win it, okay? Her husband's like, no, we're going straight to this. We're doing what they're telling us to do. So they're told us to go to this retreat. We're going to this retreat. So they go to this retreat and, you know, like, they hear all these people talking, these, you know, alcoholics, and they hear, like, all these Al-Anons, you know, and sharing about their experience of being in, you know, because when you're an Al-Anon, it doesn't teach you how to fix the alcoholic. You're fixing yourself and your relation and how you are in relation to that person. And Alateen is similar. And they went and they just saw a new world. And she said they came home and they sat down in the kitchen, and she said something about, like, they had, like, cheese, they all had sat there and had cheesecake and, like, orange juice or iced tea or something. And she said, and she's got a southern accent, real cute, and she's like, and we just talked about these people and everything we had seen and everything we had heard. And, you know, she said, we just agreed that day, like, we're gonna do this, like, we are going to do it. And and they did. And so, like, they go speak as a family now. But part of her story is that, and, like, even her daughter met, like, somebody, like, in Alex, like, it's just, like, this crazy story. She, like, married somebody, like, within, like, all of the programs. And I've never met these people. I would love to. And I know their names, like, their family. I've listened to their lead so many times. But at one point, they've been sober for, like, a while, like, 10 years or something. And the police show up at her door in the middle of the night, and her son is killed in a motorcycle accident. And when she talked about the pain that she felt inside from feeling like her heart was being ripped out, and when she talked about, like, that, you know, that she didn't want to drink, but she didn't know what she wanted to do, and that there was, she didn't know, like, how to feel inside, and that that people surrounded her that were sober, which is what happened to me, and they were there, and they were just taking care of the situation, and she didn't have to think about anything about how to, except for how to feel. And like, I related to that. And when I heard what she did with her pain and how she moved through it, you know, not how she moved on, but how she moved through her pain to the other side. Because I heard this, like, right after I came back, I realized, like, I am, like, in so much pain from my mom being gone, and I don't even realize it, you know? So when I came back to meetings, I started coming in, kicking and screaming, and I mean to tell you, I drove people crazy. I talked about my mother, literally. You think I talk a lot about her on here? You know, I talked about my mother a lot in meetings. Like, I needed to, you know? So anyway, I came home that night from that meeting, that Tuesday night, and I remember Alex and I sat in the bed with the dogs, and he was like, well, how was it, babe? And I have to say that my husband's understanding of recovery at that time was not real great, and that was my responsibility. You know, I hadn't introduced him to the people, taught him the books, taught him the texts, the language, the verbiage, the slogans. He didn't know any of that then. Now he does. He's quick to throw some slogans at my face today. You know, he knows the three C's of, you know, Al-Anon, that he didn't cause it, he can't cure it, and he can't control it. And that goes along with, you know, who I am as a person and my personality traits as well related to my addiction. And, but we sat there that night on the bed and I was so excited. And I remember he got real emotional and he was like, I'm so happy for you. He was like, this is the happiest I've seen you in a really long time. And I was like, I'm really happy too, but I'm afraid that I'm going to lose you. And he was like, well, why would you lose me? And I was like, because I can't continue to go out. This is where, like, when people say things to me, like, that they don't get it. Like, when people are like, oh, you two live separate lives. Okay, first of all, you have no idea what our life looks like and how much time we actually spend together. But people also don't understand that that's a decision that we have made, okay? That's a marital decision that we have made. People want to pass judgment on stuff every once in a while. Like, sometimes in the comment sections about, you know, my marriage and stuff, I'm like, I've been married for 8 years, okay? We've been together 11 years. This isn't like we dated for 6 months. It's not like we're kind of boyfriends. We've been together 11 years, okay? There's been a lot of, like, marital contracts that we have discussed and made through the years. There's been a lot of decisions we've made as a married couple, okay? Our marriage has not been easy. It's no effing joke. We don't plan to be going anywhere anytime soon, and we're trying our best to make our marriage last. And when you do, you go through rough times, and you have discussions about that, you know? And what happened was, I said to him, I'm afraid I'm gonna lose you. And he said, why would you lose me? And I said, because I don't want to go out anymore. I said, I don't enjoy it. And I said, I feel like I'm standing in bars having conversations with people. I don't even drink, Alex. And I said, and you know, when we go out and we dance and stuff, that's fun. But when I'm sitting in a VIP section and I'm having the same conversations with the same people who I don't even really consider friends, because I don't ever see them outside of a bar, except for maybe two or three, I said, I feel like I'm wasting my life, you know? The scene of going out today for him looks a lot different than our scene did then. Like, then it was a lot of clubs. We were going to clubs. Now, Alex likes to go out with his girlfriends and have a couple glasses of wine and sit at, I don't know, you know, he has, like, a couple favorite places, you know, downtown on Mass Ave, and they're very loungy, and you sit around, and there's a fireplace. You know, he loves that. I could have done that back then, you know what I mean? But I was bored. I just... And we weren't going out with friends. We were going out and meeting people that we knew. And they were great people. I met some great people. I had some really incredible fun times. I had hilarious times, you know? I wouldn't trade any of it. And it's part of my journey. I had some of the best times of my entire life. But at the same time, all I have in here for my nose is this little, look at this, this little bandana for pee-pee that has Dalmatian on it, and it says downward facing dog because the dog is doing it. But I just wasn't enjoying it, you know, and I was becoming resentful at my husband because I wanted to be there with him and I wanted to be there for him, but I felt like I was doing it for him. And so he said, whether you ever step your foot in a bar or not ever again is not going to change our marriage. Like, that has no bearing on our marriage whatsoever. And he was like, what do you think you need? And I said, I think I need to be going back to a lot of meetings. And I said, I think I need to get, you know, with my sponsor and really start working steps again. And I need to have a lot of friends that are sober. At least for right now. I mean, I needed to immerse myself into it. I needed, you know, like, just dive into the deep end of recovery. And he was like, whatever you need from me. And I said, okay. And he said, have you thought about the people that we, you know, interact with? And I said, I'm going to reach out to three people. And, we'll see. And so I called three people that went out on kind of a regular basis that I considered more than just acquaintance. I mean, we have a lot of friends of ours. Like, it's kind of weird how, like, over, like, I mean, this was 7 years ago, 6.5, 7 years ago. So it's kind of weird, like, some of our friends that were acquaintances then have kind of come full circle and I would say are now better friends. I mean, we have, like, two couples that we're real good friends with today. So things have changed, especially like in the last year a little bit. But like one of those couples that we're good friends with that like, you know, like I only kind of knew them from the bars, but like, you know, Alex hung out with them in Chicago, like when he was up there. They live here, but like they have kids, you know, like their life has settled down. We go to dinner with them sometimes, you know, like their life is different than it looked then. They didn't have kids, you know, they weren't like settled down in a house and things like that, you know? So I called three of my girlfriends that I was real close with that I would see going out, and I told all three of them, I said, I'm not going out anymore, but I would continue to like our friendship, you know, to be intact. Like, it's important to me. Now, one of the friends, the last time I told this, I said, like, I don't really see her anymore. And the thing is funny about that is that since I did that vlog, she and I have started getting close again. She and her husband are, like, used to be really close with Alex and I, and we're supposed to be at our wedding and all kinds of stuff. Well, when I told her that, like, I mean, they did go out all the time, but now we're seeing them a lot. So, you know, that changed. Like I said, things change, you know? I didn't just have that conversation with three people. I had it, you know, with several people over a period of time. And you know, I got real weird responses from people. People are like, so you are never gonna go out anymore? And I said, I'm not saying that. I just said, you know, like for right now, I wanna continue to be friends. But like, I mean, if I saw people, you know, places, I'd be like, oh, it's great to see you. And they'd be like, oh, the first thing they would say is, we never see you out anymore. And I'd be like, yeah, I'm not going out anymore. And they wouldn't be like, oh, let me get your number, let's hang out. It was never that, you know? It was like, oh, okay. And so, you know, of course, Tanya wasn't that to me. Tanya was my friend. And the only person out of that whole group that I continued to hear from on a regular basis was Melissa. She said, I'm not going anywhere, you know? And Melissa and I are 10 times better friends now than... I mean, I know, like, sometimes when you see her video, she drives people crazy, and people in the comment sections are like, oh my God, you talk all over each other and stuff like that. But let me just tell you, that girl is diehard. I mean, she is ride or die. She would do anything for me, and I would do anything for her. Melissa is one of the greatest people, and her husband is fantastic, too. And, you know, I've met some great people, you know, and it's interesting because, like, I said this in my video yesterday, you know, I was watching that, I don't even know what to make of it anymore, but that Josh Evans, Colleen Ballinger's ex, I love Colleen Ballinger, so it's not going to change my opinion what he has to say, but he made this video yesterday and he said he was going to bash all these people, and then he came out today and said he's not going to bash all these people. I don't know, it's just a lot. I feel bad for the guy, he's obviously going through something really, really hard. But he said on there that, you know, like when he went through his divorce, that he lost like all of his YouTuber friends. Well, when I came back into the rooms of recovery, I mean, I lost 85 to 95% of the people that I knew. I mean, true story, the people that I was hanging out with on a regular basis, because I was hanging out in places where they were, I wasn't going there anymore. And I lost all those people, and I was lonely. I was lonely. I mean, seriously, I'm not saying that as a joke. Like, I was lonely. I had my husband and I had Tanya, and that was it, and Melissa, you know? But I would see Melissa every week or two, and we would talk on the phone and stuff, but, like, it wasn't like we were hanging out every day. And so, I was like, I've got to start meeting some people, you know? And, so Alex and I made an arrangement. Like, we sat down there and I said, okay, I want to start going back to a lot of meetings. And so we had a plan set, and our plan was like date nights out, meeting nights out, or like nights that I would go to meetings. And then those nights that I went to, cause some of them, I was going to 8 o'clock meetings. Okay. For, I would say the next 2 years after I came back in, I went to every Monday through Friday, I went to a noon and an 8 p.m. every single day. So I was going to two meetings a day, Monday through Friday. Saturdays, I was going to a 2 p.m. And then I was going to this candlelight, which was at 10:30 p.m. And then Sunday nights, I was going to, I think it was 11 a.m. And that was such a great meeting. I don't go to that anymore, but it was just very spiritual. And then I was going to an 8 o'clock speaker meeting. And Alex was so supportive that we just, well, I would say the second year, I kind of backed off of it a lot. And we started doing a lot more stuff together. Maybe not so many night meetings, but I went to the noon meeting every day almost, or a day meeting every day for almost 2 years. So Alex and I, this was the deal that we had made. So, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, like he worked. And a lot of nights he would work late. Then he had a different work schedule than he has now. So he would work late. So we would both be coming home at the same time. So if I was coming home from a meeting, often he was coming home from work. So I would, you know, like 3 or 4 of those nights, we would like go out to dinner. We were eating out a lot those nights. And we would go to Cheesecake Factory or Applebee's and, you know, Puccini's and stuff like that. We were eating out a lot. And then, and that was kind of our time together. And then on Friday nights, we had date night. So I think on those nights, I did not go to a meeting. I think Friday nights, I was not going to a meeting, if I remember correctly. And I may have gone to a 7 a.m. and a noon. Can you imagine Peter Juan up at 7 a.m.? But listen, I was up every single day and dressed and showered and had my hair done and everything and at the meeting by 11:30. I mean, not even, with coffee and everything, I was, would go through Starbucks, get my coffee. I was at the meeting at 11:30 standing outside talking to people. And so I think Friday nights I didn't go to a meeting. And Friday night, but there was like a 7 o'clock that I went to. Because the place where I went to meetings had 7, 9, noon, and 8. And then on weekends they had different meetings. But it was like a clubhouse. So then Friday nights would be a date night. And that would be something like, you know, romantic. Get dressed nice for each other, those kinds of things. Spend the whole evening together. And then Saturday night was his night to go out. And I would go with my friends to a meeting, a candlelight meeting. And then we would go to start a Steak and Shake afterwards. Or just hang out or whatever. And then Sundays, I feel like he did something on Sunday evenings. Oh my God, forever, I forgot about this. Alex did this dance thing. He was in this dance group. I used to call it a troupe, and he'd be like, it's not a troupe, Peter. But Alex was part of this. So Alex is like a trained hip-hop dancer. So he was part of this hip-hop group for a long time. They would even like perform places and stuff. It was real cool. So he did that at the same time that I went to, what do you call it? My meeting on Sunday nights. And, yeah, and then, I mean, we were spending so much time together, but the same thing, like, I mean, he would go to bed, like, when he goes to bed now, and I didn't have my vlog, so, you know, instead of vlogging or listening to audiobooks, I was, hanging out with, you know, sober people, and I mean to tell you, like, it was to the point where if a new person walked into one of my meetings, I was the first one to shake their hand, because I did not want to, well, first of all, I wanted to meet everybody and I wanted to be part of that and I got excited by that and I felt comfortable with that. But then, and it was really, really good for me. It was really good for my social awkwardness and to get out of myself. And, you know, my sponsor would say, when you walk into a room, you hold your head up. Don't look at the floor because you're a person of character today. And it was stuff like that that I learned. You know, I really learned how to be a human being again and to take care of myself. You know, my sponsor would ask me, like, did you make your bed today? And things like, I mean, I was like, I'm 30, you know, I'm 39 years old or whatever, you know, like, what do you mean did I make, of course I made my bed, you know, stuff like that, and, or 41, or how old I was, I don't know, but, but I met all these people, and I became friends with all these people, and, you know, like, after the noon meeting, I would go out to lunch with people, and, you know, then I would come home, and, you know, just whatever. And then I would, you know, late at night, a couple nights a week, I would go over to their house. My one friend, she had gotten, like, separated right before she got sober, and it was, like, a year into the separation divorce, and so, like, every other weekend, her husband would have the kids, and she and I would hang out. We would, like, it was every week, we would go to a meeting, and then we would go to Chili's. This was our exciting Saturday night. We would go to Chili's, and then we, or go to a meeting, and then we would go to Chili's. That must have been before the candlelight. There was a long time before there was like a, I think the candlelight came the second year. It only lasted like a year. I took Tanya one time. I was like, should I tell a story? I took Tanya one time, and it was, so it's a candlelight meeting. And at this place, you could vape, you know, the vape pens, like, you know, the tobacco vape things, like, what are they called? You know, like, all this, you know, what they put the juice in the vapes, and then they vape. But back then, they would have, like, if you vaped, if you, like, pulled in on it, there'd be, like, a light that came out of it, right? Like, it would, like, light up. And we were sitting in this candlelight meeting. It was, like, 30 people or 20 people or whatever. And it would go, I mean, and it was just, like, doomed. It was, like, all these lights. And so when it, like, Tanya, she was so funny. She was, like, I feel like I am on a roller coaster on a, like, acid trip or something. She's, like, it is so, like, out of control in here. And I told her later, I said, like, she was laughing. She got everybody laughing after the meeting. She's like, it was just, I just didn't even know where I was. There was lights coming up over here, lights coming up over here. And I said, after the meeting on the way home, that was like the one and only time she ever went to that meeting. Now, she went to a lot of my candlelights that I went to when I changed where I was going to meetings. But that was like the one and only time she ever went to that candlelight meeting. You can't use, I don't know any meetings here where you can use tobacco products inside the meeting anymore. But, she said, I said, you gonna come next week? Because I was like every week, okay? I mean, that was like my social outlet, right? And I said, are you gonna go next week? And she said, I will never go to that meeting again. She said, oh my God, I thought I was gonna have a panic attack sitting in that meeting. She got laughing so hard. But anyway, so I met my friend, and he's gay and a little bit hippie, a little bit beatnik. My age, he's a little bit younger than me, and has a fantastic daughter, just a really cool guy, and we just became such great friends, and just the coolest guy, and just like fit into my life perfectly. Like, I, you know. So anyway, but he moved, and I never thought he was coming back. And he didn't, like, call or anything and say, I'm back in town. He just showed up, and I was like, oh, my God. So anyway, that's that. But I met, you know, I met so many really great people. It's hard, you know, like, when you're going to that many meetings, you meet a lot of newcomers. You meet a lot of people that have just come in. God, I've, like, talked over towards the end, all the way to the end of both times. And, a lot of people don't make it, you know? I remember this one time I gave this lead. Do you know those drinks, those energy drinks, they're like N2O or something like that? There was this guy, and he was probably about 60, I'd say. 65, maybe. And he'd wear jeans and a button-down blue shirt, and his hair was always, like, coming over the side. Very nice looking. He always drank one of those big drinks and sit back in the chair. And I got asked to speak, like, 6 or 7 months after I came back. I was so nervous. I was so, so nervous. I actually share this story in my lead, so I'll share it with you, but I was really nervous about getting up. I say this all the time. Like, it seems weird now that I do YouTube videos, right? But, like, but I don't see people watching this. It's different when you're sitting in front of, you know, 50 people and they're listening to you tell your story about your whole entire life and everything about it, you know? And so, and when you give your lead, you share, like, what it was like, what it's like now, and how you got where you're at. Or what it was like, how you, you know, got sober, and then what it's like now, basically. And I remember, I read it, I heard it, or somebody told me, like, pick somebody that you, like, think is confident, and then do what they do. And you'll get their confidence, okay? I don't know why in a million years I thought of Naomi Campbell, but I did. And so I like turned on music before I went and spoke. I'll never forget. I bought this shirt at J. Crew. I thought it was so cute. I was like probably 180 at the time. And I wore jeans and this really cute J. Crew shirt and tie. And it was in the summer. It was right before my birthday, I think. Actually, I think it was like the day after my birthday, maybe. Or 2 days after or something. I don't know. It was right after my birthday. And I remember in the bedroom, like I turned on music and I like walked runway up and down and the dogs just kind of followed me and watched me as I was doing it. And I remember I, you know, shared my story and I bawled like nobody's business. I mean, I think I bawled the entire time, the entire way through. I'll never forget, this guy came up to me and he said, because he would give me like these speaker CDs when I had a CD player in my car, which I don't anymore. But he would give me these speaker CDs where like from different conventions and stuff. He was such a nice guy. And he came up to me afterwards and he put his hand around me and he said, you know, I just gotta tell you, he goes, that might be the finest lead I have ever heard in my entire life. And I thought I had done like the shittiest job in the world, right? And I go, really? And he goes, now don't get your ego going, he goes, because I tell that to every single person whose lead I hear. He was so funny. He said, you told your story. It's not bad. It's not good. It's your story, period. End of story. He was like, you did your job. We don't tell our stories because it's a good story or we did better than somebody else. You just share your story, share your experience, strength, and hope, you know? My friend who got her kids are grown, not grown, but they're older now. I actually saw her not too long ago. We hadn't seen each other because she got a new job and her work schedule's changed and stuff, but like, well, if you know the story about me finding out how my boyfriend was dead, it was her house that I was at. I was like trying to show her a picture of him from his Facebook because we were talking about exes or something. And so I was talking about my boyfriend that I had when I got sober. And Todd. And what was that noise? Someone did honked their horn, but it was dying or something. But anyway, I remember looking up his picture on Facebook and all these people had written rest in peace and it was from like 2 years before and I was like, oh my God, he's dead. I remember she used to like put her TV on in the background. We were sitting on the patio or we were sitting like on the couch if it was like wintertime or whatever. And she would always have this radio station on. I don't know what it is. She must have had DirecTV or something because I don't have it. But it was like music station, but it was like not MTV or anything like that. It would just play one song after another, but it would come up. And I remember it would always have like the Pixies. She would play like, I don't know what, it was like college radio 1990 or something. Cause it was like all of these songs that I used to listen to. Like when I was like in college and high school, it was like, Well, I Wonder by the Smiths and Ask by the Smiths. But no, it was like softer stuff and like Girlfriend in a Coma. And then it was like the Pixies and the Cranberries and the Cure and that one song, it's not called 1969, but it's something like that by New Order. I love that song. If you've never heard it, you know what I'm talking about. The Pet Shop Boys. It was like all these great songs. Have you ever heard the song Liberation by Pet Shop Boys? I love that song. When he says, all the way home, all the way, wait. On the way back home at midnight. Something about you. On the way back home at midnight, you were resting on my shoulder. I love that line. I don't know why. But anyway. We used to go right back here to Jack in the Box. I remember when it was like late. We get so hungry. And we would go to Jack in the Box. And, which, We would get these ginormous cheeseburgers, just a mess of trouble. I'm not a Jack in the Box fan, okay? So it was the only place that was open because it was open 24 hours. But I will tell you, their egg rolls are really good. But anyway, I don't love Jack in the Box. I think it's kind of crap, actually. But we would go in there because there was like nothing else open, and we would get these huge cheeseburgers and fries from there, and we would sit in her kitchen, and I remember her kitchen was so cute, and she looked this little like formica table that looked like it was from like the 1950s. I remember this friend of mine that I had in high school and college. Like, we were really, really good friends, and she lives like 5 minutes from me. She literally lives probably less than 5 minutes from me, she and her husband, and we talk every once in a while. But I remember this weekend we stayed at her dad's house, and I remember, like, her dad's house was so cool. It was real art. Her parents had been divorced, and so he lived in, like, by Butler in Indianapolis. He had, like, this old house, and it had, like, French doors, like, real, like, ours had French doors, but, like, these were, like, real French doors, like, you know, because they were, like, built into the house back in, like, 100 years before and whatever, and they had, like, stained glass windows and stuff, and I remember she played, like, he loved, like, Nancy Griffith, the folk singer, if you guys know who I'm talking about. And so I remember this one night, we were, like, had all these candles lit, and we were sitting in the kitchen, there's always, like, 9 million catalogs from all of these, like, real, Jay Peterman. Do you remember Jay Peterman? I got a Jay Peterman catalog in the mail yesterday. I got on their website, and I requested one, and it came in the mail. But he always had all these magazines. There's always, like, shawls and throws everywhere. Their house was so comfy, and they always had, like, you know, an L-shaped, they had, like, this, in the kitchen, they had, like, this little fireplace, and they had this L-shaped couch that was, like, 5 feet deep, and it just had, like, 5 million blankets and everything over. So comfortable. And I remember we were staying over there for the weekend, and I don't know why. I think her dad and her stepmom were out of town, and she was babysitting her little brother. Maybe we were just over there for the night or something. Her and her sister were babysitting her little brother or something. But anyway, I remember she had these big Crate and Barrel mugs, and they still have them at Crate and Barrel to this day. And she made us all milk with cream and honey in it. And then she made us macaroni and cheese, and she made us, like, homemade macaroni and cheese. Like, well, not homemade, but she, like, cooked up the macaroni, and then she, like, put it back in the stove and, like, cut off, like, a half of, like, a bar of Velveeta, and she, like, made this macaroni, and I remember it was, like, the best macaroni and cheese in the entire time. In the entire world. I don't know what just made me think of that. I was just thinking about, like, moments in my life, you know? That's a moment I don't think I've ever shared on here before, was that weekend with her. It was so much fun. I remember we all of us, like, I think it was, like, me and two of my friends and her sister. Her sister had a friend over too. Now, her sister and I get along today, and in college we got along, but in high school we didn't get along. And I think she thought I was a bit reckless. But anyway, I remember all of us, like, laying in that bed. Like, her, I think it was her dad or stepmom's bed, like, late at night. We just, like, had, like, all of our clothes on, all these blankets, and we were, like, telling ghost stories and stuff, and we were, like, whispering, and it was so much fun. I wonder if that was my junior or my, I think that was my senior year. Isn't it funny, like, the random moments of life that you remember over time, you know? My brother-in-law, I found out, like, where his girlfriend's family rented this house, and it's, like, it's on Lake Michigan between, like, the Indiana and Michigan border. It's so adorable. Like, I would love to go there and rent a house. But, I was talking to Caroline about it. So, tonight, I was telling Caroline about it because my cousin Caroline goes to Michigan every year with her family. My cousin and her mom and dad have gone to the same place for Christmas with the same, like, 10 families. I'm not even, like, it's 10 families, okay? And it's, like, they're one of them. They've gone to the same place in Michigan literally, okay, since my cousin was, like, 5 years old. They all go every year. And they don't, stay at the same place. It used to stay at the same place, but I think they sold it. It was like little cabins or whatever. But now they stay somewhere else, like when Caroline goes up there now. And like, cause you know, not all the 10 families go anymore, but they try to go up there at the same time. And I said to Caroline today, I said, is it expensive up there? She goes, it's, Michigan is very expensive. She's like, unless you want some kind of like, you know, run down little shed or something. She was like, Michigan is very expensive to run a house. I was like, I kind of thought that. And so Alex and Caroline have been talking. I don't even know. He just told me a couple nights ago, he goes, we're going to have dinner with Caroline on Wednesday. And I was like, oh, okay. And so she picked the place. We went to Basbo's in Carmel. It was absolutely packed everywhere. It's like crazy. There's like this little parking garage over there that it's like really easy to find parking in. Somebody asked me in my haul today, so if you watch my haul, and they were like, did you go shopping at the fashion mall? Yes, I went shopping at the fashion mall the other day. But there were some things I wanted to answer on the vlog that people were asking me. Somebody said I should, I'll tell about the Caroline dinner in just a second. Somebody said I should read the book Love Janice by Janis Joplin's sister. I have. I read it years and years and years ago. It's all of the letters back and forth, if I believe I'm correct. Is that correct? And it was fantastic. It was so fantastic. That was actually, I think, where I found out that Janis Joplin had a girlfriend at one point, which is also in the documentary. Little Girl Blue. What else did somebody ask on there? There was like another comment. Elise said something. What did Elise say that I wanted to comment on in the vlog? Elise, I'm going to have to look now in just a second. But anyway, so we went. Caroline wanted to sit outside even though it was 300 degrees outside, whatever. And it was fun. We had a good time. And it was Caroline, Alex, and her son, David, Caroline's son, and I. And her husband was at home, and so we just kind of sat there and talked, and we were there for like 2 hours. It was really nice. Okay, I pulled into the gas station. The battery died. What is that? My phone is dead. I had to charge it on the, I had to put the charger on. Sometimes when I turn the camera off, it'll give me a little bit more on battery. I don't have my other battery with me tonight. So anyway, we went to dinner with Caroline and Alex and David. It was fine. We had a good time. Anyway, we were telling funny stories. That was it. I hope you guys are having an amazing, what is tomorrow? Oh, it's flashing at me. I hope you guys are having an amazing, what is tomorrow? Thursday. Unless you have other plans, next time you see me, I'll have had a haircut. And unless you have other plans, but don't have other plans, have the most amazing day of your entire life. Enjoy it. Do something for yourself. Do something new. Do something fun. I don't know. Do something incredible. Oh my God, it's flashing. Okay. And if nobody else has told you this today, I love you. Look at yourself in the mirror every single day and tell yourself, I love you. I love you. And most importantly, make sure to pass it on to somebody else. Treat yourselves well. Treat yourselves kind. Be compassionate, kind, and loving to other people. I love you guys, and I will see you tomorrow. Bye. Love ya.